فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى Today we're going to be starting the explanation of the book القصيدة الهائية في الزهد والترغيب والترهيب written by العلامة الحافظ الشيخ حافظ ابن أحمد الحكمي رحمه الله. This book, my beloved brothers and sisters, is from one of the great works that this great alim, الشيخ الإمام حافظ ابن أحمد ابن علي الحكمي wrote. The Shaykh rahimahullah is very famous for his husn al-tasnif, the good authorship, the good writing that he does, wa jamal al-mu'allafat, and the beauty of his works. And he's also well known for his jawdatul manzumat. He's also known for his jawdatul manzumat, in which he has written in different fields of the religion. In those books, if you read them, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he mentions ilm ghazir, great amount of knowledge in it. And he establishes and he proves taqrirat nafi'ah. And you can see from his works, he's very strong in his istidlalat, the way he extracts rulings from ayat. And he's also well known for his age, rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Hafiz al-Hakamiyyu only died at the age of 38. And from the first books that he wrote is his kitab, Sulam al-Wusul ila ilm al-Usul, in which he then explained it later and he called it Ma'arij al-Qabul. He authored that book when he was only 19 years of age. And he authored it with the request of his teacher, Al-Imam Abdullah al-Qar'awi rahimahullahu ta'ala. The author, this book that we're going to go through inshallah ta'ala, he has written it in a particular field. He's talking about az-zuhd, which is asceticism from this dunya, and it is to abstain from its glamours and its glitters, and that your greatest ultimate drive as an individual, it should be, and your ultimate knowledge should really not be this dunya, and that it should be the hereafter. He talks about the harms that this dunya carries and the reality of this world. He, rahimahullah, points out in this book, inshallah ta'ala, from the things that bring the destruction to an individual and prevention from any form of good is when he opens his chest and his mind towards this dunya. The Shaykh rahimahullah, like his other works, قَدْ أَجَادَ وَأَفَادَ, he has truly given this topic justice. Even that though he summarized it, he only wrote it in 39 lines of poetry, roughly 40 lines. يَا إِخْوَةِ الْكِرَامَ, beloved brothers and sisters, احْتَوَتْ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا وَنَفْعًا عَظِيمًا, this book has carried and it carries a lot of great amount of good in it, inshallah ta'ala. And he himself, Hafidh al-Hakami rahimahullah, is not the first person to write in this particular field. Other scholars have written in this particular field, speaking about az-zuhd. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, he wrote about zuhd. Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he wrote a book in Kitab al-Zuhd, called it Kitab al-Zuhd. Waqi' ibn Jarrah al-Ru'asi, he wrote a book on zuhd. Hannad ibn Sirri, and other than him, have all written in this field of az-zuhd. And a student of knowledge who's seeking knowledge, he requires and he needs أن يقرأ ما كتبه أهل العلم, to always read these kind of books. The reason why he will do that is because أن تتهذب نفسه. So your nafs, you can nurture your nafs properly, and you can give yourself tarbiyah, and that your heart can be steadfast, and that your situation can change for the better, and that you don't also get caught up in the fitna of this dunya. I also want to mention that this book has been explained by two noble mashayikh. One of the mashayikh who has explained this book is Shaykh Zayd ibn Muhammad ibn Hadi al-Madkhali rahimahullah, who died. He has a ta'liqat, he has a little explanation on the book. He called it At-Ta'liqat al-Bahiyyah ala al-Qasidat al-Ha'iyyah. And he is a student of Hafidh al-Hakami rahimahullah. Shaykh Zayd was a student of Hafidh al-Hakami. And there's also a sharah, an explanation by a Shaykh Abdul Razzaq ibn Abdul Muhsin al-Badr. So inshallah ta'ala, without any further ado, we should start the explanation of the book. Qala rahimahullah, the author said, وَمَا لِي وَلِلدُّنْيَا وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي وَلَا مُنْتَهَا قَصْدِي وَلَسْتُ أَنَا لَهَا وَلَسْتُ بِمَيَّالٍ إِلَيْهَا وَلَا إِلَى رِئَاسَتِهَا نَتْنًا وَقُبْحًا لِحَالِهَا. So he starts by saying, وَمَا لِي وَلِلدُّنْيَا وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي. So he started his book with this line, clarifying that the dunya hasn't taken him captive. He says, وَمَا لِي وَلِلدُّنْيَا, what is it for me in this dunya? وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي, it is not my goal and it is not my ultimate goal. So he's trying to clarify that the dunya has not taken his heart as a captive, and it hasn't gained any love and passion in his heart, as it's the situation of many, many Muslims and many people rather. And the only person who would say a statement like this, this statement of وَمَا لِي وَلِلدُّنْيَا وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي, is a person who truly understood the reality of this world and the trials and the tribulations that are in it. And that the dunya, it is only glamours and glitters, and it's a mirage. There's no reality behind it. The author, rahimahullah, got this statement from the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it's in the hadith of Ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhumah. And Umar, that Umar, he entered upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa huwa ala hasir. The Messenger was lying down on a hasir, which is it's straws that were brought together like a mattress kind of thing. And the Prophet was lying on it, qad athara fi jambihi, it affected, and the signs of the mattress, it wasn't a mattress that we have, it's straws. So the sign came on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's side. So Umar saw this and he said, Ya Nabi Allah, the Messenger of Allah, لو اتخذت فراشا أوثر من هذا, if only you were to take a mattress, a real mattress, if you only sleep on something better. فقال, the Prophet responded by saying, مالي وللدنيا, what is the relationship between me and this dunya? مَا مَثَلِي وَمَثَلُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا كَرَاكِبٍ سَارَ فِي يَوْمٍ صَائِفٍ فَاسْتَظَلَّ تَحْتَ شَجَرَةٍ سَاعَةً مِنْ نَهَارٍ ثُمَّ رَاحَ وَتَرَكَهَا. What is the relationship between me and this dunya? I am like nothing except the way that me and this dunya are to each other is like a man who looked for a shade under a tree for a portion of the day, and then he made his way back to what he was doing and he left the shade. I am like that. I am coming into this world and I'm only going to use from it, and I'm only going to benefit from what I want, and I'm going to keep it moving. Wallahi, my beloved brothers and sisters, هذه, this is the halul abd fi dunya. This is the situation of a believer in this dunya. Is the fact that he needs to enjoy this dunya and to have fun? Is that the truth of what this world was for? Ya ikhwa, the Prophet saying to us, alayhi salatu wasalam, it is like a mathali rajulin, it's like a man istadalla tahta shajara faraha wa tarakaha. It's like a person who looked for, who stood under a shade. When he looked, when he stayed under the shade, he left it when his needs were over. You are like this in this world. And do not let this universe and this world take over your heart. Then the author goes on to say, وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي. What does he mean, وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي? It is not, أَيْلَيْسَتْ بِبَطْلَبِي وَمَقْصُودِي وَهِمَّتِي. It is not my desires, it's not my ultimate goal, it's not my objective. Rather, my objective and my goal is directed towards the hereafter, he's trying to say. وَلَا مُنْتَهَا قَصْدِي. And it is also not that it is, has not taken over my goal. Rather, what I'm trying to receive is رضوانullah عز وجل. I want Allah to be pleased with me. I want الفوز بدرجات العلا في الآخرة. I want to gain a high level the day of judgment. Then he goes on to say, ولست بميال إليها. The word ميال means أي لست أما ليس عندي ميل وانشراح صدر ورغبة في الدنيا. This dunya, I am not diverted towards it. I'm not leaning towards it. In other words, my heart is not open for it at all. And its beauty and its glamours and its glitters, no. And leadership, and no. That's not my raghba, that's not my himma, that's not my goal, that's not my... La. And this, my beloved brothers and sisters, that the author is saying, it's something not only for him, but that should be the situation of who? Ala kulli Muslim, every Muslim, an-nasih li nafsihi, that's sincere to himself, who wants the best for himself. This is how his situation should be, ma'a hadhihi dunya, with this dunya. Ya ikhwan, let's not get fooled bimata'iha zail. Let's not get fooled by its portion of beauty, the temporary glamours that it has. And we should not also understand from the statement of the author rahimahullah ta'ala that we shouldn't also take from this dunya what we need, and that we should forsake our worldly gain. No, not at all. And that we should be poor and we should... No, not at all. But what the author is trying to say is, don't let it be your ultimate goal. And the messenger used to seek refuge in Allah from that. He used to say, وَلَا تَجْعَلِ الدُّنْيَا. Oh Allah, do not make this dunya أَكْبَرَ هَمِّنَا, our ultimate goal. وَلَا مَبْلَغَ عِلْمِنَا, and don't make our knowledge all about this dunya. Some people today, they only live for this world. And how do you know a person has made this dunya his akbar ham, his ultimate goal? Is that he has not placed in his schedule, he has not yet started to work and say, you know what, I have to stack up for the hereafter. Rather, what that person does is that he just makes his ultimate goal this world. So you see him working. He's himarun bin nahari, jifun bin layli. He's like a donkey at the day, meaning he's only working, he's gathering. Wajifun bin layli, and he's like a corpse at night, the way he sleeps. Alimun bin dunya, jahilun bil akhirah. He knows the dunya, the ins and the outs. You ask him about anything related to the dunya, he knows it. But when you see him pray, tata'ajjab, you're amazed with the way he prays. The religion, he can't read Fatiha. No, the religion has no importance for him. The Prophet used to seek refuge in Allah from that. Also, the Shaykh is not trying to say that you shouldn't provide for your children and you shouldn't gain any income. No. That's something that the Prophet ﷺ told us in the famous hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, that the Messenger ﷺ said, إِنَّكَ أَنْ تَذَرَ ورثتك أغنياء خير من أن تذرهم عالة يتكففون الناس. For you to leave your children and your offspring rich is better than to leave your offspring and your children poor, begging the people. So yes, it is good to work. And yes, it is good to make money. And then so you can leave for your children, that which they can inherit from you, so they are self-sufficient and they won't need to ask from the people. That's what the Prophet told us in this hadith. But what the Shaykh is saying that, do not make this world your ultimate goal. Asceticism, in regards to this dunya, if it's not understood in the correct way, my beloved brothers and sisters, it may make the person and a human being enter into deviation, mukhalafat shar'iyya. And the person may actually go against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, believing and assuming to themselves that they're getting closer to Allah by it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ the people who now call themselves Sufiyya, al-tasawwuf, one of the things which they say that they are about is zuhd, and that they are aesthetic. They turn away from this dunya and they are more towards the hereafter. But if you truly look at their understanding of aestheticism, if you look at their understanding of a zuhd, you will come to realize that it's an understanding that goes against how the Sharia understood it. They misunderstood the concept of a zuhd ala wajhiha in the way it should have been, and the way that the Sharia perceives it. In reality, my beloved brothers and sisters, this universe, this world that we're living in, we should truly understand its reality and how low it is and how fast that it's perishing and it's going to go, and that it's cursed and everything in it is cursed. The only thing that's not cursed, as the Messenger told us, is the remembrance of Allah and righteous deeds and things that will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith and Imam Tirmidhi narrated and Ibn Majah, and the Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, he graded it to be Hassan. That the Prophet said, "Inna dunya mal'una," that this world is cursed. "Mal'unu ma fiha," and everything in it is cursed. "Illa dhikrullahi," except the remembrance of Allah. "Wa ma walaha," and what shows allegiance. "Wa 'aliman aw muta'alliman," a scholar or a student of knowledge. So this dunya is cursed. Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab Iddatu al-Sabirin wa Dakhiratu al-Shakirin, Iddatu al-Sabirin wa Dakhiratu al-Shakirin, he mentions in the page 331 that the world in and within itself is not cursed. But what the cursing is referring to is, he said, فَالدُّنْيَا فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ لَا تُذَمُّ وَإِنَّمَا يَتَوَجَّهُ الذَّمُّ إِلَى فِعْلِ الْعَبْدِ فِيهَا. He said that the dunya in reality is not the thing that's rebuked and the thing that's scolded and belittled, but rather what it is إِلَى فِعْلِ الْعَبْدِ, the slave's actions. He goes on to say, وَهِيَ قَنْطَرَةٌ وَمَعْبَرٌ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ أَوِ النَّارِ. This world is nothing except a bridge which we're all crossing to either Jannah or Nar. ولكن لما غلبت عليها الشهوات وحظوظ والغفلة والإعراض عن الله والدار الآخرة فصار هذا هو الغالب على أهلها وما فيها. But he said, when desires overcame this world and the glitters and the glamours overcame it, and heedlessness and turning away from Allah and turning away from the hereafter, then صار لها اسم الذم عند الإطلاق. Then it became rebuked, and then it got scolded. وإلا but rather فهي مبنى الآخرة ومزرعتها. But if the person, for example, the opposite takes place, for example, he takes this unit world as a place where he stacks up, and that he makes sure he takes this dunya as a place where he does righteous deeds in order to enter Jannah, then there's nothing to rebuke here. Because this person has understood the reality of the dunya. And there's nothing wrong in this regard. Then the author goes on to say in, Rahimahullah, هي الدار دار الهم والغم والعنا سريع تقضيها قريب زوالها مياسيرها عسر وحزن سرورها وأرباحها خسر ونقص كمالها إذا أضحكت أبكت وإن رام وصلها غبي فيا سرع انقطاع أما فيا سرع انقطاع وصلها. The author says, Rahimahullah, in these lines, clarifying the reality of the dunya and the reality of the people. He says, هِيَ الدَّارُ, the dunya is a place. Which, what is it? دَارُ الْهَمِّ وَالْغَمِّ وَالْعَنَى. This dunya is a place of depression, sadness and sorrow, anxieties. This is something that's going to happen to everybody. However much money you're given, however much leadership which you gain, however positions that you get, فَلَنْ يَسْلَمُ مِنْهَا, no one's going to be saved from الْهَمْ وَالْغَمْ وَالْعَنَى, stress, distress, sadness, sorrow. Everyone's going to go through that. However much money you get, and however much leadership and positions you are given. The author mentions, سَرِيعُ تَقَضِّيهَا قَرِيبُ زَوَالُهَا. The dunya perishes quickly. It goes fast. The person like who doesn't gain that depression and that distress is a person who truly understood this world and used it as a means to pack up for the hereafter. That's why Allah said in the Quran, فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى. The one who follows my guidance, he will not be misguided in this world, and nor would he be from the people of the hellfire the day of judgment. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. Allah tells us in this verse, any male or female who does righteous actions and believes in Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, I will give them a life of happiness, a life of goodness. But how? Why did they gain that for? They came with iman and righteous actions. فَلَنُحْيَنَّوْ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا means a yas'ad, he will find happiness. وَيَهْنَأُ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, and will find tranquility in this dunya. But what is upon you, my beloved brothers and sisters, for you to find that, is you need to turn to ibadatullahi, worshipping Allah. وَاللُّجُوءِ إِلَيْهِ, turning to Him. وَالْإِقْبَالِ عَلَىٰ طَاعَتِهِ, and also facing the obedience of Allah. وَتِلَاوَةُ الْقُرْآنِ, and reading the Qur'an. And believing also in what? وَالْإِيمَانُ بِقَضَاءِ الْقَدَرِ, believing in that which Allah has destined for you subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, and Shaykh al-Albani authenticated in his kitab Silsila Ahadith al-Sahiha, that the Prophet said, مَا قَالَ عَبْدٌ قَطْ إِذَا أَصَابَهُ هَمٌّ وَحُزْنٌ. No individual is ever afflicted with distress and sorrow, sadness, except if he says, Allahumma, O Allah, inni abduka, I am your slave, wabnu abdika, I am the son of your slave, wabnu amatika, I am the son of your female slave, nasiyati biyadika, my affairs is in your hands, O Allah, madin fiya hukmuk, your rules, O Allah, is what takes place on me, adlun fiya qadauk, your judgments on me is fair and it's just. As'aluka, O Allah, I ask you, بِكُلِّ اسْمٍ هُوَ لَكَ, I ask you by every name which you own, سَمَّيْتَ بِهِ نَفْسَكَ, which you have called yourself, أَوْ أَنْزَلْتَهُ فِي كِتَابِكَ, or you have sent it in your book, أَوْ عَلَّمْتَهُ أَحَدًا مِنْ خَلْقِكَ, or you have taught anyone from your creation, أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك, or you kept it to yourself in the knowledge of the unseen. I ask you with all of that, أن تجعل القرآن ربيع قلبي, that you make the Quran the spring of my heart, ونور الصدر, and the light of my chest, وجلاء حزني, and you make it the remover of my depression and my sadness, وذهاب همي. The Prophet said, no one makes that dua إلا أذهب الله همه وأبدله مكان حزنه فرحا, except Allah removes his distress from him and Allah changes it for him happiness. Then the companions, they said, يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, ينبغي لنا أن نتعلم هؤلاء الكلمات. It's upon us to learn these words then. If that's the case, then it is upon each and every one of us to learn these words. The Messenger said, أجل, yes, of course. ينبغي لمن سمعهن أن يتعلمهن. It is upon everybody who hears these words for him to learn it. Now, if you look at the things that were mentioned in this hadith, you will truly come to understand that what the Prophet mentioned is صحة المعتقد, having a good belief. In the hadith, in this dua, what is being mentioned is that your aqidah is correct, and you believe in the qadr, and you believe in Allah's names and attributes, and that you do tawassul, intercession, and you only call on to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also, the consideration of the Qur'an is mentioned in this hadith, because the person says, أَن تَجْعَلَ الْقُرْآنَ رَبِيعَ قَلْبِي, that the Qur'an is the cure. All of that which is mentioned in the dua is actually مُدَاوَاتِ الْهُمُومِ وَالْغُمُومِ. It is the things that remove distress and also removes sadness, and it also removes any depression. Then the author goes on to say in, سَرِيعٌ تَقَضِّيهَا قَرِيبٌ زَوَالُهَا. Even though this world has depression, sadness, sorrow, agony, pain, it is quickly going. It is سَرِيعٌ مَا تَنْقَضِي. It's actually going very fast. And it is nothing that's going to last for very far. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, when the people came and they asked him about the hour, and they kept asking him about the hour, Allah sent this verse on him, which Allah tells the Prophet, يَسْأَلُكَ النَّاسُ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. The people keep asking you about the hour. قُلْ, say to them, إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. When the hour is going to happen, Allah is the one who knows. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّ السَّاعَةَ تَكُونُ قَرِيبًا. And what makes you guys know that maybe there is a chance where the hour is very close? Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ. The hour has come close. Also says in another ayah, اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرُ. Also Allah also says in another ayah, إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. They see it to be very far, but we see it to be very close. So this dunya is something that we should not see as though it's going to remain forever. It's actually fast in the way it goes. Then the author goes on to say, مَيَاسِرُهَا عُسْرٌ وَحُزْنٌ سُرُورُهَا. The author says, مَيَاسِرُهَا عُسْرٌ وَحُزْنٌ سُرُورُهَا. The good that's in this world, and the health that's in this world, the opposite, hardship, pain and agony, is with it. So ever good that you come, there you go, you see the pain again. So you are in a state of what? Ease and joy. After a period of time, hardship and pain and agony comes after it. So the person is what? Consistent situation, or he's in a consistent changing of currency and change. One time he's in a state of happiness, a state of joy, a state of enlightenment and happiness, and then a while back, time to come, is then hardship, pain and agony. The author then says, وَأَرْبَاحُهَا خُسْرٌ. the gain that you get from this dunya and the things that you achieve from this dunya is also loss. It's really, really nothing you gain from this dunya. And the Shaykh is not talking about religious gain. He's talking about worldly gain. Because look, all of the money you've made that you've ever lived, when you die, none of it goes to you with your grave. You've lost all of them. Your wife is going to go and get married to another man. Your children are going to be under the shelter and the care of another man. You as an individual, you lose your own name. They don't refer to you as your name anymore. Even before you get put in your grave, they call you the dead body. They carry the body. Your name is the body now. You've lost everything which you owned. So there's no gain from this dunya in terms of its worldly gain. But religiously, na'am, a person can gain religious gain from it. If he works hard, comes with righteous deeds, then yes, he would gain. وَأَرْبَاحُهَا خُسْرٌ Look at the people who establish businesses. The business collapse. They file bankruptcy. That's the reality of this dunya. وَنَقْصٌ كَمَالُهَا He goes on to say, وَنَقْصٌ كَمَالُهَا Deficiency is actually the completeness of this dunya. The dunya is actually complete by being deficient. So the state, the time which you can actually say to yourself, this dunya is complete. Wow, it's actually at its pinnacle for me. It's actually a deficiency in its reality. If the slave tries his hardest to gain from it consistent and continuous happiness, the dim-witted one, if he tries to do that, he won't gain it. The chain of happiness that you were going through, the good, something has to come and break that. وَلِذَلِكَ Ibn al-Qayyim says, سُرُورُ الدُّنْيَا أَحْلَامُ نَوْمٍ The happiness of this dunya is actually a dream of a sleeping person. أَوْ كَذِلِّ زَائِلٍ Oh, it's like a shade for the one who's using a shade. The sun is not always out, so he's using a shade. Just like that goes, the shade goes, it's like that. إِنْ أَضْحَكَتْ قَلِيلًا أَبْكَتْ كَثِيرًا If it makes you happy sometimes and it makes you laugh sometimes, then it makes you cry a lot. وَإِنْ سَرَّتْ يَوْمًا أَسَاءَ الدَّهْرًا If it pleases you a day, then it saddens you and hurts you years to come. وَإِنْ مَتَّعَتْ قَلِيلًا مَنَعَتْ طَوِيلًا If it gives you joy for a short time, then it prevents from you a lot. It stops from you gaining a lot. And then he brings a statement of who? Muhammad ibn Sirin, who said, مَا كَانَ ضَحِكٌ قَطٌ إِلَّا كَانَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ بُكَانٌ Ibn Sirin said, there is no laughing whatsoever except what comes after is a crying. That's the reality of this dunya. You see a group of people laughing, joking, wife and husband just laughing with each other. Years to come, they all depart their different ways. Either the wife dies or the husband dies or divorce and they go their separate ways. Where is all of that laugh? Where did it go? That's the reality of this dunya. It's nothing that's consistent and that stays. I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, conclude there bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. We really want to take very small segments and really ponder and analyze bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Any mistakes or shortcoming that I might have come with while I was explaining is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.